Thank you very much. It's really a big privilege to talk to you today. I've got 20 minutes. I don't know. I think it's going to feel like drinking from a hose a bit, but I'm going to try my best to tell you a little bit about a few aspects of the fast evolving world of payments from a parser perspective. So what are we going to talk about? I've been asked to slant my presentation a little bit towards the debit side, mainly because DebitCheck actually was our first ISO 20022 implementation, and DebitCheck actually required a lot of digital interaction from a mass market. And one often wonders then, you know, how does a mass market then suddenly respond to the imposition almost of a payment system that requires a digital interaction, and what some of the blockages that people actually have about debit systems. So a few learnings from DebitCheck. I also want to talk a little bit about principles that need to underpin some of our payments, future payments system designs and so on. And I'm actually advocating a bit of a principle-based approach to how we think about the future of payment system, not just debit payment systems, but payment systems in general. And then I'm going to jump across to the credit side and just give a very, very high-level broad view of how I also see the future of the credit side of payments. Right. First of all, I just want to say I'm from PASA, and if you don't know what PASA is all about, PASA is appointed by the Reserve Bank or mandated by the Reserve Bank in the NPS Act at this stage still, to, together with our members, manage the payment systems in South Africa. Now, who's our members? At this stage, our members are only the banks. There are 32 of them, and they, together with the banks, we basically manage the payment systems, which means we regulate the payment systems. We set rules, and we make sure that everybody abides to those rules, and if certain of the members don't, you know, then there's some compliance actions that follows, and even sanctions. We manage basically 18 payment systems. The one right there at the bottom, I've got a laser here. No, it doesn't work. I thought I'm going to shoot this thing out. But settlement is moving across to the Reserve Bank. Because the RTGS sits at the Reserve Bank, the whole management of the settlement aspect is going to sit in the space. So going forward and in future, we will only manage 18 of these payment systems. But it's a lot. And we manage them in what we call participant groups. So it's groups of members that actually come together in committees. We call those PCHPGs or participation groups, and we set the rules for the various payment systems as is indicated here. PASA's role in modernization has always been very involved. You can see in the various payment systems that I'm indicating there that in card, in low-value credits, debits, high-value, and even with paper, check, we were quite involved in modernization and in many of the projects, you know. So since we are focusing a little bit more on the debit side of things, right in the early stages, you know, when we brought about an early, when there was a need for an early debit order system, we were very involved in ADO and NADO and actually setting up those payment systems together with our members. That evolved around about 2014, from 2014 till about 2020, thereabouts, into DebitCheck as the new payment system, ISO 20022 system that replaced the old ADO and NADO. And we are now moving forward into a future debit ecology. Now, I think the main purpose then today is to talk a little bit about this future debit ecology, how would it look, and also to contrast it a little bit to the credit side of things. Right, so let's jump in. I think the first important aspect to emphasize is that direct debits or debits is a feature of a national payment system that will always remain. So as big as credit payments or push payments actually is in the context of not just our country, any country, debits remain important because big parts of certain corporates' receivables are collected via these debit systems. And they can't do without. And hence, they are very, very involved with setting the tone and determining what they actually want, what kind of use cases they are putting forward that these payment systems need to satisfy. And I think for us as PASA and also for our member banks, it's often a challenge to make sure that we still remain busy with a national payment system and not getting too much into the business models of all these big corporates that have a lot of muscle to actually say we want this, we want that, and such, you know, so that we actually kind of be clear on where does a payment system's responsibility start and stop, and where is it then you and your business model and the risk that you take. And you can't expect the payment system to mitigate all of it. We basically have three payment systems, which you see on this side of the slide here, on the right-hand side as you look at it. Two of them collect in the early window. So directly after a credit is actually being deposited, they collect the money for the corporate. The one is actually an interesting story, which is registered mandate services, and actually just derived from DebiCheck. DebiCheck is actually the main system that is being built, and it's an authenticated system. So what does it do when a user, let's say Virgin Active, sits with you and confirms a mandate to actually collect on a monthly basis? In DebiCheck, that mandate is now digitally captured, sent through the payment system to the paying bank, held on a register there at the paying bank, and the paying bank will only collect in terms of the terms of that mandate. So anything outside that is rejected, you know. So that brings a lot of safety and a sense of security also to payers, because they know nothing will be collected that I didn't agree to. I think that's the big value proposition about DebiCheck. The interesting part about RMS is RMS was literally just a derivative, almost a crutch, that was established in the early parts of the DebiCheck system to allow that same kind of digital mandate to be created and to be collected on, but without the authentication. So, and that was just because we saw very, very low authentication rates in DebiCheck, and we'll come to that in a moment's time, because that's part of the digital message here. Why is the digital adoption of things like that so difficult? The registered mandate services still collects in the early window, but it's just a temporary measure. It's been allowed by the Reserve Bank, and it will be pulled out in a fairly recent or quick period. So I think we're talking about quarter one next year, where a registered mandate will then be pulled out, not collect in the early window. DebiCheck is the only mechanism or debit order system that will collect in the early window. RMS then will collect in a later window, be processed later on in the day. So, and then obviously you have the late window collections, which is currently the old EFT system. It's an old system, it's a legacy system, it's highly efficient. There's still a lot of users in it. There's about 44,000 users that use this system compared to 21,000 that uses the other two. So a lot of activity still in that space. But we also have to think about debits and collections in the context of other things that is starting to happen and are actually growing. The one that we see most obviously is card subscriptions. Card subscriptions is a highly efficient way to actually also collect money on a recurring basis for whatever service. Very soon you will start to see that PayShop also delivers a capability which is called a request to pay. And that request to pay could evolve very easily into a recurring request to pay, where it basically comes down to the same fact. Somebody asks you or sends you a request to pay, you confirm it, although it's a credit push type payment. The result is the same. You know, you've authenticated or agreed to so many payments of this amount, and the system basically affects that. I think just important to understand that those things will in time, I think, challenge the traditional debit systems as we go forward. Right. The debit system journey then, as I've indicated to you, has been one where a big part of the effort went into sunsetting the two legacy systems, ADO and ADO, and actually building DebiCheck. But we are now in a space where we're looking at the future priorities of debit orders. On the one hand, we are enhancing DebiCheck. We're constantly looking at ways to further enhance DebiCheck. But on the other hand, important is the separation of RM actually establishes a new debit payment system, ISO 20022, with a digital mandate capability that could, in time, replace EFT debits. And I actually want to be as bold as to say it will replace EFT debits. It's a matter of time before that will happen. Together with that, I think we are driving also towards pool-type platform convergence opportunities. In other words, to make sure that a platform can actually deliver both a kind of an overlay mandate initiation service for various payment systems and then a collection capability. The future, in other words, if I can illustrate it to you diagrammatically of debit systems, is going to be one where, if we look at where we currently are, RMS is still very much part of the DebiCheck system, and you've got EFT debits in the blue, in the light window. Going forward, or now, this year, we are busy with the separation. Quarter one next year, you will actually be here, where we actually have a new payment system collecting also in the late window, standalone payment system, much more modern, much better features like tracking and validation and all of those things built into the new payment system, competing with EFT. EFT, the question then is, what will we do? Move it, retire it? You know, I think the decision is almost obvious, you know, that in time EFT will disappear and you will actually see a future where you have two ISO 20022 systems, the one collecting in the early window because it's authenticated and therefore you can apply stricter dispute rules and such, the other one in the late window with a different kind of dispute rule regime, if I can put it that way. A couple of things that I just want to highlight around establishing growth and to advance in this kind of environment is the importance of principles. So what I'm advocating here today is you can't drive payment system modernization without having a strong set of principles that underpins what you are going to do. Otherwise, we are constantly going to get resistance from the industry about no, not this, not that, and so on. But the moment we take it back to principles, people start to say, okay, they nod and they say, okay, we understand, you know, why this must be this way. And to, for instance, highlight a few, you know, that we made very explicit is, like, for instance, let's take number one here. The national payment system should not be used to support flawed business models. Now, what you did see in the collection space is people started to defer their risk appetite issues onto the payment system to actually give them 100% secure collections. And you can't do that. You know, you can't actually displace your business model responsibility or issues onto a payment system. So we basically say, if the business model cannot survive with dependency on certain rules and processes in a collection system, then the business model is flawed. And we are putting those things very forward, very much forward. Another thing, you know, you would see in the debit space that currently we've got around the disputes, because any pool system must have a dispute procedure linked to it. We've got something called the 40-day rule. So after 40 days, you don't immediately give the person's money back. You don't reverse without any questions asked. So there's a process now kicking in. But that process basically requires a bank to be the arbiter on who's now right. You know, are you the collector right? Or, Mr. Payer, are you now correct? You know, should I reverse or shouldn't I reverse? Now, that is flawed. You know, that's in principle flawed. And if you didn't crystallize those principles very clearly, we would have continued with a 40-day rule, you know, forever and ever. Over and above the fact that it's a highly inefficient process as well, which evidence actually made very clear to us, you know, principles like this starts to challenge aspects of the process. I'm not going to go into all of this, you know, it's a job to actually talk through them, but I do want to make the point that in payment system design and in modernization, it is actually critical to crystallize those principles. And if you are from other jurisdictions and are involved in the modernization of payment systems, take this learning from us, that we really started to see that the progress becomes faster and easier if you are in agreement on the principles and if the principles are crystallized. Right, so our immediate response then in this space is in terms of that diagram. So we are currently busy with some thresholds for non-face-to-face authentication to make sure that this can be written into rules, to make sure everybody at least subscribes to a technical delivery threshold on which those messages needs to be delivered. We're also busy with a lot of enhancements. I'm not going to go into all of those, but things like emergency services, session and assignment, all of those things. We are busy with the big project is actually the separation of registered mandate services from authenticated collections or debit check as we know it, and then continued improvement, you know, where this whole all the work around dispute rules is currently also falling in. Let's get to the last part, the last two parts that I briefly would like to cover. The one is, so if you think about it, debit check was our first ISO 20022 system that required a digital response from the mass market. How did the mass market respond to that? So, first of all, I can say that we are still struggling as we stand to actually get decent acceptance rates or authorization rates of digital mandates. Now, remember, what you're doing through this is you're presenting via a device or something a mandate or parameters of a mandate to a consumer, and you ask the consumer to respond digitally to it. And one would think this is simple, it's easy, you know, because we are busy talking about something that you're either buying or a service that you want or something. Why wouldn't you kind of respond to this digital interaction that is now required for you? And I can tell you it's been a massive, difficult job to actually just get a digital response. So the big learning is, let's not assume too much about digital interactions and the propensity of the consumers, and especially consumers in the mass market, to actually really respond to these digital interactions. So a lot of people say they recall getting, let's say, a digital message that requires something from them or a response of some or other nature. But a lot of them don't respond. You know, our response rate is, as we stand here today, still about 50%. You know, so half of it just disappears. No response, you know. And then if you ask the person, so why didn't you respond? It's perhaps important to kind of look at some of the high-level things, that, takeouts, you know, that behavioral study that we recently did actually highlighted to us. So first of all, busyness. You know, in my day-to-day stuff, you know, this thing now pops up and asks for me to interact with a banking aspect thing. And it doesn't make sense where and how and so on, because sometimes it's a few hours later and it's not linked to the conversation that I had where I'm buying a service or I'm buying a product or something like that. People also don't understand the actual message, you know, because it's a complex thing. You're actually presenting a mandate and you're saying, this mandate now is for you to agree to 5 collections of so many rands starting on this date and ending on that date every 20th of the month, something like that. People don't respond to those things easily, don't understand them. What is interesting about this also is that a lot of this is not properly explained. So when there's a user, a counterparty on the other hand, asking you to interact digitally with a payment system, it becomes clear to us there's a lot of education necessary. So you would see that in things like they don't understand the messages, the process is not clear to them, and then obviously also technical issues. Globally speaking, though, you know, it's not one single thing that actually contributes to this low authentication rates that we're actually seeing. It's a number of things that together contribute. The ones with the biggest impact or weight are the ones here, perhaps in the top row, and those two there, which basically just, I think, speaks to a large extent to education and lack of explanation and so on when you interact. I think the picture that it tells us is when you interact with the mass market in digital terms, you have to be on top of your game in terms of education. You have to be on top of your gains in explaining exactly what this is all about so that people understand, so that people trust. There's a big curve for us still to grow our ability to do those kinds of things. So Debit Check then, and the digital interactions that Debit Check ask, you know, so the majority of the respondents, yes, they would say, you know, it's easy, it's convenient, it's empowering, but there is still a lot of negatives. You know, it's security is raised as a big issue. People don't trust these digital messages. They don't understand those digital messages. They don't know how it fits in. That's where the confusion part comes in. And they're often also frustrated because digital interactions assumes airtime, my cell phone is working, the cell phone tower is working, all of those kinds of things that don't always happen. Right, so that was a quick offload on debits, you know, where we are with the debit space, you know. So a lot of movement in the debit space still, principally based decisions that we are taking. I think a lot of things in the pipeline now with a new registered mandate service that would take the place of EFT. On the credit side of things, I'm not going to go through all of the detail, but I just want to say we now at PayShop. PayShap is South Africa's rapid payment system, and that came out of a study that was done much earlier that was called Project Future, where we created a view on if we had to kind of spell out a modernization journey, what would it be based on? And we basically said it would be based on the fact that we want to find a payment system that is better at replacing cash, that it becomes the go-to payment system, the everyday payment system for everybody, and that is what PayShap is. But many people forget about this, and that is that PayShap is also the first part of a new credit push payment system. So the rails on which, or the platform on which PayShap is built, is the first part. I think this picture perhaps says it better. Is the first part of a kind of a platform architecture or a layered architecture in which all credit payment systems will function going forward. Now, currently we've got all of these things separate silos. Going forward, there's going to be one single credit push payments platform. The scheme might be called PayShap, and it might have certain limits and such, but we could easily accommodate bulk payments on there as well. And that's the future, you know, that we could call it another scheme, PayShap. And I spoke to Stephen Linnell the other day, and his preference is that we create different schemes, although it will run on the same payments infrastructure, it will be a different scheme. So we'll call it PayShap Bulk or PayShap Plus or whatever, you know. So that's make the distinction between infrastructure and scheme. I think important for this room to know is that the Reserve Bank themselves, and I don't think I talk out of turn, because it's been announced on public forums already out there in the public, are going to or want to play a stronger role in that kind of infrastructure that is being established. So a more hands-on role, if you can put it that way. How are they going to do it? You know, that's not for me to speculate from here. But it might be that they're just going to mandate certain things or going to play a stronger role. But they want to make sure that that South Africa has an easy payment system like India's UPI or Brazil's PIX, which is strongly being driven by the Reserve Bank, and they call this the public sector digital infrastructure, and that this public sector digital infrastructure is then available and at a very low cost to actually do what it's supposed to do, to uplift the economy and to make sure that everybody gets involved in these kinds of payments. So the future of payments, I think, is dealing with this architectural challenge of separate or siloed payment systems throughout the whole payment process, pre-transaction, right through to clearing and post-transaction. These things are all built to different standards. They are very siloed, you know, it's very fragmented, and so on, yet all the data tells us, like for instance, bulk payments, or batch payments, around about 70% of same-day batch payments, around about 70% of EFT payments is same-day payments. So you can imagine how many me paying you kind of payments is in there that you could just as well push through a real-time payment system. And I think that's the direction we are moving, is to actually move those things through. So I won't be surprised if RTC actually is the first candidate to be retired very quickly, and those transactions typically move through this kind of payment rail. Whether it will be with connected to the 3,000 limit, or whether there might be a PayShap Plus, we don't know how that will happen. But you know, it just doesn't make sense to have two systems actually doing the same thing. So, And then obviously if the credit, you know, even if salary payments and those things require a delay, that kind of delay capability can easily be built into the same system as an overlay service. So that's, I think, the direction we'll be going. So what's the future? The future is a single universal payments infrastructure or payment system on the credit side. Various overlays that could provide us with services like QR, like proxy, like request to pay, like an ability to delay and bulk up certain things for a while before you release it. But in essence, the same kind of infrastructure or clearing rail that is actually being used for all of these payment systems. Right, that was a drink like drinking from a hose, wasn't it? They're asking if I should take a few questions. I'm quite willing to do so. Any questions?
Going once, going twice.
There's a.
Okay, we'll take one question only. We'll take one question. One question. Your question.
Okay, hi, I'm Yari with Absa CIB. I really enjoyed your presentation on debit check and the information that you were presenting around the low uptake. I'm keen to hear your thoughts on, I think, looking at the bank perspective, do you think that it's not being incentivized as much? That's why there is low uptake. So if you look at your rewards from banks, if maybe they coupled that and said, if you uptake this debit check on with that specific bank, you actually get these points that are added to your rewards. Do you think that might curb the uptake? Besides the education point that you made, I do resonate with that. When it was first introduced to me with a bank consultant, there was no education or information around what it is. It was just gone to your bank, approve this. So I do resonate with why there's low uptake of it, but I just wanted to hear your thoughts around maybe if there are incentives or rewards linked to it, could that increase the uptake?
Yeah, remember what the payer experience is their own bank. You know, so if you were Standard Bank, you'll see Standard Bank coming to you with a request to authenticate a debit on behalf of somebody else. I don't think Standard Bank would want to pay incentives if Virgin Active is actually sending that request. So I don't think that could work. However, if you think about it, you know, if the user themselves say, okay, if you approve your debit order at Standard Bank, I'm willing to give you a month for free membership or something like that. That could work. You know, I think we must be innovative about those things. The strange thing that we do see around DebitCheck, you know, despite the low authorization rates, we spoke to an insurance company day before yesterday that indicated to us that 70% of their book is already on DebitCheck, you know. And I was surprised. I said, how did you get this right, you know? And they said, it's just pure focus, you know. They set themselves a target to actually get all of their policies and so on through DebitCheck, and they're there, 70%, you know. That's great, you know. So it's possible. I think it's a matter of focus. I do think, you know, the world is starting to slowly shift towards DebitCheck.
Thank you so much. Really do appreciate for the presentation. Very comprehensive. Thank you.